Yes. You know what? In Arizona, it was 46 degrees this morning.
Wow, that's like, I don't know, like minus, that's like, isn't that about where like atoms start to freeze? Isn't that something like that?
Let me just tell you, I had to wear layers.
Layers in Arizona. Layers in Arizona sounds like some sort of travel novel or something. It's a good title for something. Layers in Arizona. Yeah, hey, I know. Let's pitch it to Netflix, and then we'll all be rich. We don't need anything else. Just the phrase "layers in Arizona." They're going to go, yeah, we want that.
Rom-com. We got to get Matthew McConaughey.
All right.
Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, gang. Yeah, Kara is pointing out 40 in Arizona is like minus 20 other places, and I still don't know because you're talking Fahrenheit, and I have no idea what that really means. So. Anyway, it is a cold, gross day, like gross, grotesque and gross. Both versions of that word apply today here in Eastern Ontario. It's hovering around the freezing mark. We are having a smattering of snow in places. All the leaves are off the trees pretty much. So it's the rude time of year here. Rude, just rude. Anyway.
We don't like rude. I'll bet our guest is in a really lovely location, Chris. Who are we talking to today?
Well, we have Zsolt Oláh joining us today. And so, Zsolt, tell us where you're from, literally, right now, and then give us a little bit of your bio, I think, in case people haven't bumped into you in our world yet.
Sure. First of all, thank you for hosting me with the show. I've been a couple of times, and it's good to see that it's still going strong, and there are people interested in to see what's happening around us. So my name is Zsolt Oláh. I actually changed jobs through the summer with this crazy 2020. I don't know how you are doing in 2020, but this is nothing like ever for me. So I changed jobs in 30 days ago. I work for Amazon AWS now. So a lot of cloud computing, high-tech sort of thing, but the training side of it. And I was just chatting with Brent that this is the first time in the last 5-6 years when I'm really, really close to the business. It's not in the L&D bubble that some people kind of have and fight through. I'm actually really close to the business, the consultants that I work with. So it's refreshing and exciting. And if you haven't seen me before, 20 years in the industry, mostly technology and learning kind of combined. I wrote a book, Engage the World, 2 years ago. It's still out there. If anybody's interested in it, nothing to do with 2020, go for it.
Very good. And geographically, where are you today?
Geographically, sitting in Philadelphia in my daughter's room because she went to college. And finally, I have a room to broadcast for until she gets back.
Oh, the joys of departures. You suddenly have spaces back.
I'm in the same old room myself. There's a little bed right on the other side of the office, which doesn't seem appropriate, but.
Well, I'm in the office and there's no bed.
Yeah, well. But. Probably was no daughters living there either, so.
Well, no, not in the corporate headquarters, no.
Yeah, it's kind of sums up 2020 of never leave your room. All your adventures is coming through online virtually.
Yeah, how's your commute then? You've got what, 20 feet down the hall every day?
So actually funny because my daughter said that she used to love the train ride to school and now she doesn't have it. And I said, yeah, I actually picked up a habit of changing my shirt. This is my commute at the end of the day. I change my shirt and that signals my brain that work is over because nothing else changes.
I have a short commute of about 50 feet across from my lawn because my office is in the garage and it's not connected. So I have that commute and my wife will, you know, joke about the traffic, which largely consists of chipmunks and squirrels. So, but anyway,
did she pack you a lunch for the ride?
Do you know what the nice part? So I've been coming back to the office, our headquarters office on Wednesdays to do these sessions again. One day a week in the official office. And the nice part is that there is a shawarma place in the neighborhood so I get to have shawarma for lunch rather than leftovers. So, you know, it's the little things in life. So.
It is. Well, let's not just bore people with our enjoyable office antics. We're here to talk about a non-framework. Zsolt and I were talking earlier. I want to make sure this isn't a framework. It is a, and I'll let you fill in the blank, Zsolt.
Yeah, so I think people are here more about picking up some kind of practical advice or trying new things rather than listening to us three guys talking about the boring life of commute. So the topic today that we kind of picked and talked through is this, what Brent kind of advertises a framework, but I want to make sure that we're all out there understanding that there's frameworks, there's models, there's all kinds of things, theories out there, and that is backed up by science, and you have all these books and read and that sort of thing. This, what we talk about today, is more like a thought process or a technique that you can use, and I want to break it down into pieces and kind of like showing what I've drilled down in 20 years into a practical way of approaching problems. And then you have your own tools to plug in. So I'm not going to tell you what authoring tool to use here, and I'm not going to tell you what type of analysis you need here or what kind of platform. That's not what we're here. It's more about what is the thought process to start with, hey, we need training, and all the way down to actually create some impact more than courses. So that's kind of the premise.
Very cool. And you have a very catchy acronym that kind of covers the basis of what you're doing.
Yeah, I always wondered about acronyms, whether they start first and then you kind of plug in and forcefully make it work, or that comes after, like, hey, this is an acronym. Great. So either way, I think Reframe has started as a starting point for me. And Reframe is actually a technique, cognitive reframe used in psychology. It's basically showing the world a slightly different way so you can reassess your problem. And that works well for, you know, PTSD therapy, when you look at the events differently and you see actually different solutions because your frame is sort of different. But if you haven't done any of that, you're not into psychology, like, what is it? Why are we using this in training? What does it mean? We take a frame and walk around. So I have a little kind of intro to that, just to understand what reframing is. So for that, I need a little help. Has anybody here ever gotten a speed ticket? We can be honest. you more than one?
No.
I have a... I think three.
Couple of them. Oh, yes. Okay. So,
here. So it's like you just get the thing in the mail that says you got to be driving too fast. It's like, what? Come on. I did not.
All right. So, speed ticket, you get fine. You pay the fine or whatever, depending on the country, I guess. So, I imagine that this is a problem because there's just too much speeding going on the highway. So you're approached by the government or your organization or whatever, that we need training. And this is a big problem. So right now we need a good approach of reducing speeding. And so as an instructional designer, you jump in, you have maybe like a brainstorming of what could go well. So we can maybe do a game that you practice, and then you get like points, leaderboards. It might be something that more sophisticated, a whole simulation. It could be something like simple as a PowerPoint, bored to death. Whatever those things are, we all go through our process, build out our solution, and put it out there for people. And that's kind of like traditional, we don't have no time. This is our process, this is our tools. Let's bring it out, put it out there, and see what happens. So Reframe is kind of looking at the same problem, but slightly differently. So before you jump in and start executing and building, go through a slightly different thought process, and mostly a thought process. And this is what you see on the screen in the middle. So the first one is actually stop where you are and think about your own thinking. So what is the problem that we're solving for? And there's one simple question that I use with stakeholders. And I know it's kind of bizarre, and you don't want to use this because it sounds like you don't know what you're doing, but it actually helps them understand what the situation is. The simple question is, how do you know that this is a problem? So many times experts come to you and they already have their solution in mind, and all they need to know is when you can deliver it, and then they move on. And here's your deck. Once you ask them, how do we know what the problem is? Then they probably start getting into more of, okay, speeding. Like, you know, how many speeding tickets we're sending out? This is crazy. We need to reduce that. That leads you to conversation around, okay, so the number of speeding tickets is our target. How big is that? You give you a number. This is the number. Okay, great. So this is good. The starting point, baseline. Let's reduce that. And that moment, you're actually starting looking at this problem a different perspective, because one simple way of reducing tickets is not giving out tickets.
Yeah.
You don't need any training. Hey, just let people drive and then there's no more tickets. We'll solve the problem. Another way of looking at it is if you're measuring speeding by the number of tickets, then maybe remove the speeding limit. Well, here's Germany. You can drive as fast as you want. Problem solved. So now you're looking at a problem from a very different perspective, talking about how do you measure it? What is that exact problem we're solving for? And that conversation leads to what we're solving for is not really reducing the number of tickets out there. It's actually the accidents. And now we have a bigger problem, a bigger question, and a bigger audience of, okay, who's involved in that? There's the authority, there's the law, there's people who are driving, there's people who are speeding and all that. And now we've got a bigger problem, but a much better chance that it actually solves something, which is about reducing accidents. And it might be that speeding is a small part of it. It could be that distraction is a much bigger problem that we should solve for. So to get to the point of asking, hey, what is the problem and how do you know it's a problem, all the way to let's throw out crazy solutions like, what if we're not paying, you know, what if it's not a fine of money because people don't care about it, but time? Let's say they have to sit there on the road for 4 hours. Would that change anything? Or so another thing out there, maybe actually pay them not to speed. And if they got speeding high, then we start reducing that kind of income. Very different approach. Nothing to do with training. It's now becomes a behavior change approach. And part of it could be training, but a lot of things around is how do we change the behavior rather than what course we create for the end.
Mm-hmm. We had the step away design team on last week talking about creativity. And it seems to me that this is a place where they were offering us, you know, stepping back from something, hence the name step away. Well, Chris, you ever smart making that connection, but you know, that pause not just jumping straight in believing that you have, say, a solution. You know, a lot of their focus is on maybe solving problems that you haven't been able to solve yet, etc. But again, that reframing or that pausing, thinking about it differently. A lot of parallels there for what we were talking about last week.
Yeah, I think that definitely jumps into that part of it that I think a lot of instructional designers and a lot of folks who may be in the chat today, maybe you guys can jump in and just let us know if this is the kind of thing that you get confronted with. But I think a lot of people still feel like they don't really have the control or the authority to be reframing questions, right? And do that. It's just, you know, is there a tactical way that we can be applying this and doing this rethinking and reframing of the question at another level down that doesn't involve maybe a new instructional designer in the industry having to influence up and say, hey, this isn't a training problem. I've rephrased the question and here's what you should be doing.
Yeah, I totally agree. And this is not something that you turn on as a switch and say, from tomorrow on, I'm going to reframing everything in the organization. good luck with that. So one of the problems I saw that there's no time in the process and the whole instructional design process is just built in, is that you cannot argue with someone who's in the 24th hour to deliver something within the workplace when there's egos and politics and whatever is happening and projects that, oh, let's just sit down and have reframe. And I know this great thing. We can sit down and brainstorm and like, no, it's not going to work. So you most of the time when you start this reframing, you start with actually delivering what they want and do little nudge things and change things. Because if you don't deliver what they want first, you don't get trust. You don't get credit. You can't change anything. It's not a, you know, institutional change. From now on, I'm not an order taker please let me know when you need a problem so I can solve it for you. So once you deliver and they know that you can do it through that process, you can also say, hey, how's your boss measured on this? What would be something bigger than what we're delivering here? Are you really solving the problem? 60 days later, let's go back and talk through it, how it worked, and have some ideas that maybe could be different next time. But deliver first, because otherwise it seems like you're just wasting their time.
Or just you're being a pain in the butt and or a blocker or a barrier or, you know, a problem child.
I mean, it's 2020. You know, 10 years ago, software releases happened like once a year. It's like every 3 weeks now. I work at AWS just to keep people like cloud computer specialists up to date of what's happening in the cloud computing is a problem. There's already a shortage of time because there's so much going on, so much change. So there's no way that you can sit down and say, oh, in 4 weeks, we're going to deliver some kind of course for you to solve this problem. By then, the problem is gone, probably, or a different problem arises.
That's interesting. Joe Cook put in there, she likes what you were saying, and you have to be where people are. And I like that. I've often said that. I don't think I've used those exact words, but it's like just, you know, us needing to help people develop at the level that the developers are at and help them develop at the level that they're at, but also allow them to develop the solutions they need to develop that they're being asked to do, and that incremental sort of growth, and help them just kind of move along a little bit, whether that's in their development of building a solution as an instructional designer or e-learning developer, or whether that's taking it another level up and saying, hey, maybe I can influence and we can start doing some different types of solutions that impact at that higher level.
Yeah, I think that people are crucial here. And this is a second kind of layer on this, because now you stop, you know, think about this, look the problem in a different way. But the next thing is that you actually have to have the right people in the room. It is no longer, I think, a one-person magic thing that an instructional designer sits in a box and comes back with the perfect idea of how to solve problems. You need to have orientation. You need to have the business, HR, whatever those elements are. This is why it's important to understand how they measure things and what they're looking at and who owns those numbers. If you can get to the guy who says, hey, I can change your number, here's a different way to approach that you have probably a much better idea of or chance that you can have a pilot than just looking at how many people, you know, completed the course per se.
Mm-hmm. Question in the official question path here. I found that identifying the right stakeholders is an issue. And particularly when you're using human-centric design mechanisms, thoughts about how to engage stakeholders that are decision makers and also stakeholders that are users.
Yeah, so I think one of the problems that everybody is facing is that people are busy first. It's hard to get to the real decision makers. So they send someone who's either voluntold to be part of a project, or in many times they show up and no idea what they're doing. They just assigned to this program and night virtually they show up on your webinar and okay, what do I do here? So I think it all starts with the numbers and the measurement and the baseline of where you're trying to get to. Sometimes the people that you work with, they actually have no idea what those numbers are. All they know is that we need to deliver this training because it's part of a big, you know, HR initiative, and there's 3 days here that people need to complete it. So the one thing that that helps understand is having an agreement of when it's over, how do we know that we delivered something that you call an impact? Who's going to measure that? And then from kind of going backwards, okay, so there's a KPI number here that customer service numbers needs to go up. Who owns that number? Who actually measures that number? How do they measure it? Who can influence that number? If we don't understand how we measure something, we're not going to be able to change it. So then this starts like exploring more of the the avenues of who are those stakeholders who can help you with that. And again, it comes with a lot of pre-work of lunches that you spend or whatever you do to build connections with those people, and not just, okay, now let's bring in some engineer who is the most expensive person to bring on. Excuse me. It doesn't work like that. First, that person needs to understand, like, hey, I'm actually adding them value here, and this is how I work with you. So definitely expanding the stakeholders, including the ones who you think are going to be an obstacle. Sometimes we ignore those and we just work with the the promoters. And then you suddenly see that the execution of the program is not working because you completely ignored the managers. You went straight to the, you know, customer agents. They're not going to do anything unless the manager supports them. So there's has to be a good way of collecting stakeholders first.
Yeah. So we're probably not going to be able to run through the entire acronym in a great deal of detail, but I did post it up into the chat, but maybe let's move from the first rethinking and just run quickly through the other ones, just so we've at least thrown them all out there in a bit of a teaser fashion, at least to get people sort of framed about the reframing.
Yeah, so think about it as you stop, you have the three thinking of what are the questions are we asking for, what numbers are we looking at, so kind of a baseline. Then you explore what people are involved, who are going to move those needles, and who needs to be involved in decision-making. From there, I think Kathy Moore has a great, I think, probably the most practical approach to learning with action mapping. There's a lot of other things that you can do and use tool-wise to get to the problem. But the point is in that layer is that you need to understand the whys. So you know, kind of identify what people should be doing, but you need to understand why. For to do that, you can do a lot of, you know, design thinking and bring people in the room and empathy mapping and that sort of thing. But if you don't include the end users who actually need to be changed their problems or behaviors, then all you do is just wishful thinking. And at the end, you may or may not reach your approach. So that's kind of like the core part is understanding why people are not doing what they're not doing and how we change that. Because that from that point, you have all kinds of almost like blowing up a problem into small pieces. So now you see, okay, here's a problem. They don't know where the software tool is. We don't need a training for that. I just completed a training when there's a history of how to work from home. Do I really need to understand the history of working from home or just need to understand those five steps that works best? Probably go with that. And that's just 5 minutes or 10 minutes of my time, but it adds up. So all these things can be broken down to first of what the source of the problem is. And then from there is, I think, where we again missing some of the tools is let's have a brainstorming, but assume nothing and throw out all kinds of bad ideas that you have. So things like, what if we just ignore the speeding at all? What would happen then? It may not be the solution itself. So lots of bad ideas can lead you to actually very good ideas. Because most of the time, the first one is, it's an okay idea, but it's not the best one. To get there, you need to throw out all these ideas. And then the final stage is that we sometimes struggle with is, don't try to build the perfect solution and then start selling it, because that's going to take months. Figure out some of those ideas, what would work, what would be a good pilot to show impact, and do an A/B testing, run it. We have all the technology now to do that and see the impact. And there are two reasons for that. One is that you can do it fast, and if you fail, it's not working, there's no point of building it on. Two is that, and this is more like, I think, the corporate world, if you show quick action and any small of tiny impact, then you get all the support suddenly. Now people listen to you like, hey, did we do this? Great, can we do X? Now you have people actually want to join a pilot and you have to actually keep them out. Like, hey, we're just doing small, but you need to show something that you can prove that you can impact. And then from there, you can have a much better audience and better support to complete things.
I'd say that's great advice. And this might be just a little bit off topic, but just from a career standpoint, I'll just point out like that the idea of showing progress, even if it's really quick, small bits of progress, especially when you're engaging new teams or engaging a new stakeholder within the company or whatever, it's extremely valuable. That's why I think that last one is one of my favorites. And I kind of like, I kind of like the list from the bottom up. I love that one. And I love the make lots of bad ideas. I would like to talk a little bit about that from the perspective of how scary that is. I mean, it's, you know, being comfortable in trying to quickly iterate a whole bunch of potential ideas as part of that brainstorming process, and then sharing those can be a little bit scary, even if it's when you're with your direct close colleagues. And I know a lot of people like to have something polished, even if it's like a beta version or something, before they start bringing in other people, you know? And so, I mean, I don't know if just a comment. I don't know if other people have ways of dealing with that, or if you've got some thoughts on that, Zsolt.
Yeah, a couple of things. Some of you mentioned human-centered and design thinking. So this is kind of part, you can use design thinking for that, that part. And I've done a lot with instructional designers. And when we run into the problem is they're so accustomed to create something, show it, and as a final, because I don't have time to reiterate or even just like people think I'm crazy because this is a brand new way of doing things. So they're focused on the first thing that they always done and worked, and it works most of the time. The problem is when we're solving problems that we don't know how to, it's probably not going to work. So one thing that I do with them is actually going for quantity versus quality. So literally they're told in 10 minutes to come up with as many as they can. You can make it a little bit gamified, rolling a dice, and you have to get rid of ideas that you roll. So there's, you need to have a lot more because you're kind of losing them. Whatever the approach is, you're focusing on the numbers and not the quality yet. Later, you can throw them out and move them around like, hey, this is crazy, or company would never pay for that. That's fine. But when you brainstorm, you need to, that's one. And two is, brainstorming often happens in a weird way that we think that people being in a room and we're the brightest people, and then suddenly we come up with great ideas. There's a lot of people out there who had great ideas, but they're not going to say a word in a room with everybody else, because the loudest, the extrovert, the A to B thinker coming up with all these things, and by the time you get to yours, like, okay, it doesn't seem like it's a good idea. So if you do brainstorming, send those out, like, here's the topic, go think about it, bring it back or submit it, and then we combine these things in one. Things that you had time to think about it and people on the fly. And you get much better results than just putting people in the room, especially now online when only one person can dominate the room. Mm.
Chris is so right in connecting this conversation with last week's conversation with the Step Away folks, because my experience hanging out with them for a week last year was exactly that. I mean, I was, if you go back to some of those recordings talking about it, I even did a little podcast with the three of them talking about my, I didn't bring a business problem to the event. And so I kind of had to think up something that I wanted to do that I was going to try to solve a problem for. And I was so frustrated, and I was like, it was hard. It was really hard to go through it, but the creative process that they put us all through, that was totally disconnected from the problem, actually helped kind of get us all thinking differently about the problems that we're dealing with, and having to iterate it and having to brainstorm it and all of that. It rings so true. And I think for a lot of folks, when they're sitting here hearing something like this, or if anybody's listening to the replay, it sounds really easy, you know, when Zsolt comes on you about it and oh yeah, I totally agree. But until you actually get in and do it and deal with your own emotions and your own biases towards the idea and the topic, it's a lot harder than it sounds, and you have to practice it just like anything else.
I completely agree with that, especially that. So this is not something that you take. Here's the seven steps. You take it to your organization. It's like, okay, this is what we're going to do from now on. Everybody is different. Your culture is different. For example, at AWS, learning is just so essential, because otherwise we would never actually expand or innovate. So learning is one of the things that we do all the time, curious people like that. But at the same time, an organization who's more established, more hierarchical, learning something new or trying something new is always shake up the playing field. And yeah. people who already had a good way of leading, now suddenly there's someone else who tries something new, and maybe that works, but mine is an old fashioned. So there's a lot of politics going on and all that. So you need to pick your pilot well. You need to have a champion who's gonna drive. And what's funny is that it works well in crisis when people are like, okay, fine, I've tried everything. We need to solve this one. Let's try this new thing. Fine. Go with
that. You wait till the stakeholders have thrown their hands up in the air. Do whatever you want. I'm done.
Yeah, I would do this as a last resort. So don't start your, you know, tomorrow. I was like, I'm going to wait until there's a crisis here. And I'm going to say, okay, here's the solution.
It's kind of a Machiavellian approach to L&D. Yeah, Harold points out it appears the process will depend on the organization's culture. So we've got, and we were talking earlier, even just about the first in the start of our conversation, how someone's bringing you something and it's last minute, that's not the time to implement a whole new way of doing something, because you're not going to get the buy-in, you're going to get resistance, et cetera. What are some of the other blockers that you think exist then, Zsolt, in terms of moving towards a framework like this?
So the resources obviously is one thing. So if you have a team, and you can spread things around, that's much easier to implement something like new and pilot on the side than if you're a one person department, or you just literally so decentralized that what I'm doing here could be completely different than what I'm supposed to be doing, and nobody is actually can force it into other part. So one, I think, tip that I can give, which is the most common things I always hear, is that we don't have time. And here's 75 deck slide deck thing, and everything is important. And we need to put this in. And if you say no, because you know that it's not gonna work, and two is that I can't even shrink the font into like 4 or 5 to put all these texts on one screen, then what happens is that this is without the reframing, that what the SME hears is that you're saying that his 75 page thing that they collected is not important. Because in their mind, the output that they want and the intention is one thing, it's the same. So this is where reframing kind of comes in. And what I usually do is I say, yes, it's very important. I can see that. In fact, let's talk about it, how people can get to this content, this so important content after the course, because they might not forget it. They didn't want to get to that. And that sounds like, okay, they understand that it's important. And in fact, it should be somewhere accessible. And once you get to that path, then you can open it up like, what if we don't put all of this stuff here, but put in this and tell them to go there when they need it? And now you're actually opening up resources for yourself of actually focusing on things that make sense and maybe do an exercise around it rather than putting stuff on the screen.
Mm-hmm. I had a very enlightened client team once that needed to do the sort of annual ethics kind of training, and they put they were right off of the bat. They said, no, the PDF, there's a 27 page PDF with the policy, and that's going as a resource and people are going to read it. What we need to do is we need to work through some of the practicals of this, like what happens in certain cases. It's not about ticking the box in this case that they read it. They have to attest anyway that they read this. So that was a total luxury, was being able to work with a team that was prepared to, move in that different direction in a parallel fashion.
It's an interesting struggle that I think we all deal with, all of these elements. And I think, like, for me, the main takeaway and just thinking through the acronym of Reframe is a really good quick way and a good quick little exercise to just help you remind yourself that, hey, maybe the struggle, the roadblock, whatever, it is just, we just need to step back and we just need to rethink it. And I think these quick little trigger points that you've created kind of help, because it's going to be different in every situation.
Yeah, so it could be a 5-minute exercise literally in your mind when someone comes into a room. It could be a 6-month long project. Because if there is actually data and you need to compare, and it is a risk, and because of the volume, maybe it's a security, maybe it's because it involves so many people, then you just don't run through this anyway. So you need to stop and maybe you spend a whole month on the first part, which understanding what KPIs are driving here. Maybe the KPIs don't exist. I've seen in many places when they create a pseudo KPI for that. So rather than actually using financial numbers, they create something that's a combination of customer experience, service, and financial numbers. And then here's the formula that we're using for. Here's what we have now. Here's the 6-month baseline. Let's try to move that, which technically as a proxy will define our numbers too, but it's way too down the deep to use financial ROI and formulas connecting to training.
Very cool.
Do you have any, where as we sort of approach the end of our conversation, do you have any tips unique to the 2020 situation? I know we've kind of brought that up a couple of times. You and I were chatting about it in the green room a little bit, right? The whole COVID pandemic and all of that. Is there anything we can do to apply this? I mean, this seems like really the perfect time to be looking at a framework like this and applying it, you know?
So obviously working for AWS, the year was a crazy quick going online year from every angle, from governments, NGOs, from corporations to small places who just basically relied on face-to-face, everybody went online.
Yeah.
And with that, the fear of learning online is now in mountain heights, because a lot of people in overnight became gurus of online learning. And then what happened is that they basically take whatever they had before, and now on a webinar, they do the same. And it's amazing to see, if you go on LinkedIn and search, how many people are now offering coaching and writing books and whatever that nobody cared about before. There were a couple of them, like Joe over there, Lightbulb Joe, who'd been doing this forever, and Cassie Labori and all that. But now everybody is doing that and all online. And so what didn't change was the audience. They're the same people and same problems, but now this brand new way of solving problems is not working for them. It wasn't working for them before, but now it's even worse because it's all online. So I think one tip is, it's not enough to have a technology to deliver these things. You need to understand what the technology does plus for you and use that advantage. It's like if you're reading a book and you want a TV series out of it, you don't just take the book and read it on TV. Like, you don't have to understand what a TV does extra with actors and emotions and faces and story. Otherwise, it's just reading a book online.
Mm-hmm. The optimist in me feels that maybe, the pandemic is itself, a reframing, and therefore presents an opportunity for people to think about doing things differently and perhaps doing things better. I mean, all with that within the context of, crap, this pandemic is horrible and et cetera. But, hopefully the some of us have had the opportunity to then take this as a reframing, because we have to do things differently. We're no longer being able to work in the same rooms as people. We're no longer able to even, meet in the same ways. And maybe that's an opportunity for itself to be, a reframing of a lot of the habits that we've acquired over the years.
I completely agree with that, Chris. So this is where reframing comes in. Instead of figuring out, okay, we used to be in a room and we had a whiteboard. We need a whiteboard. So how do we make a whiteboard online? And you buy some technology that has a whiteboard in it. And it doesn't feel like a whiteboard. It's limited to like clicks, cracks and things on the screen. It doesn't work. Instead of figuring out what we were using the whiteboard for,
right,
the collaboration part, and how can we make that happen online even better than what we had in a room? And this is where like brainstorming comes in. Now you can do it individually. Miro and other collaboration tools can do that. Excuse me. That you give them 10 minutes to throw as many ideas on the board as they want. Don't have to talk yet. And then start collecting.
And as you've already pointed out, the benefit of that is that it's not being driven now by a single voice or a single personality. you know, which is something that the webinar idea kind of reinforces anyway. And it's also implicit in, or a contextually, when you put 12 people in a room, a couple are louder than the others, a couple end up driving everything anyway. So it ends up producing a more democratic result and an opportunity for better ideas that might not have arisen. So neato.
Yeah.
Very cool. I think Brent had tossed some contact info for you in the chat, but Zsolt, if you want to throw in anything there, I don't know if you want to have folks reach out to you on LinkedIn if they're looking to connect, those sorts of things. We'll make sure that we get that tossed in here as we bring ourselves to the dancing time again.
So. Yes, I think that I thought I heard the music coming. I heard the trumpets unpacking earlier.
Yeah, they're tuning up. I can tell that in the background.
So before the music overwhelms us here and start dancing, Brent, if you can capture the questions in the question, like five of them, and just send it to me, I can answer them, and then in some way we can create some kind of a Q&A and deliver.
Yeah, we'll keep the conversation going.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Brent usually posts a summary, so maybe we can include that as part of the summary blog post. Of those. A couple of them are technical questions, so the list just got shorter for you, Zsolt. Awesome. All right. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. It's been awesome. The chat was, as always, an activity in itself, and so much going on there. So thanks so much for your active participation, folks, in joining us in the typing angle of things. Enjoy the rest of the day, guys. Let's dance on out. Thanks so much, Zsolt, for joining us.
Thank you, Zsolt.
Thank you so much for everyone.
Have a great week, everybody. Great weekend. And don't forget, hey, we're here every Wednesday. We'll see you next week. I know you're all waiting for that cool special effect.
Yeah.